put off by how long this video is. Don't worry, I try to jam-pack my videos with as much content and as much detail as I possibly can. Anything I feel I can comment on and that I feel you might be interested in, I pretty much put in the video. I try not to repeat myself and talk fairly fast. If the video is too long for you, I have recorded a shorter version and the link will be in the description box. Shadow Warrior 2013 video game review. You are modern ninja mercenary Lo Wang, the head assassin for the Zilla Corporation. You are trying to retrieve a mythical sword, the Nobitsura Kage, for Zilla during a demon invasion from the Shadow Realm. The sword you see in the hands of this golem with a mask on its face, and you pursue that golem. And you start to suspect that maybe Zilla's intentions aren't pure. There's not a lot of plot here, though there is a pretty decent amount of backstory. And with, you know, in the first one, magic was part of the world, but you weren't seeing a lot of like magic being done, where here it's, you know, you and your enemies are using magic all the time, and it, you know, it adds personality to the game, where I like the original one fine, but it is basically a slightly, you know, a slight upgrade to Duke Nukem 3D. Duke Nukem 3D is an incredibly memorable game. I never even heard about Shadow Warrior until, you know, much more recently when I got both this and the first one on sale. And, yeah, the part of the reason is that it's just not as compelling of a product, and in this case, I think they did a lot to that by, you know, making enemies use magic powers, and more to the point by giving you some magic powers that, yeah. Some have found the plot to be confusing. I do think that the way it's told is a bit, yeah, you can understand why some people have a little trouble with basically the backstory, I should stop referring to it as plot, because really it is backstory. There's very little plot. There's the bad guy, there's you, and there's this MacGuffin, and that's basically it. And the backstory explains how we got to where we are, but yeah. Basically, the backstory, I'm not going to give away exactly how or why, but basically, there are points in the game where, you will get a brief, exposition dump of backstory, and over the course of the game, as you get more and more of these exposition dumps, you can piece together, you're actually told what happened backstory-wise fairly early on. From there on, it's basically what were the motives behind what happened. It's kind of a mystery story kind of thing where, yeah, you have the base, you see the crime scene, you know what happened, now you're trying to figure out why. And I mean, I'll give it this, I was fairly engaged, and I found the conclusion to be fairly satisfying. I was actually, over the course of it, I realized that things were being set up for a potential sequel, which it is underway. So it's not like, it's, which, if it hadn't been well received, which it was, and I've gotten that sequel, and it's annoying to have these, basically plot points that are set up for a sequel. I don't know what the plot of the sequel is going to be, but I know, I could tell you right now, if I wanted to spoil it, which I'm not going to, the plot of this game, such as it is, several elements that are almost definitely going to be in the next one, and they're only here to be set up. You don't realize it right away, but once you see how certain elements are going to, are playing out, you realize this is going to come back the next time. And it's just, can we just tell one story and then expand the world after that? It's just annoying when things are clearly in a story so that they can come back when the story is continued, rather than really adding. Because you could so easily, some of these elements could easily be given closure in this, and other of the elements could just be removed entirely. But the story does end. There is closure. You're not, I find way too many modern games end, recent games, end with this thing of, okay, so that's basically like, okay, it's basically ended, but then what now? What exactly is going to happen after this? It's annoying when something doesn't properly end, and this does properly end. And again, I was pretty satisfied. Whenever one of these exposition dumps would happen, I took it in. I found it to make sense. I was engaged. I wanted to find out what had, why what had happened had happened. And in addition to motives, there are also people's involvement with different things, and you don't know what at the very start, you're told of some of these different characters that were involved. You don't know immediately what these characters are like. You don't know. You know what they did, and you maybe get an idea of what their role is, but you don't know what, in addition to their motive, just, that's just saying what were they trying to do in that one instance. You get a sense of who they are as people in general. And the plot, the backstory is basically, not really a spoiler. It's about what happened. I may not have already said, but the demon invasion is from a place called the Shadow Warp, the Shadow Realm, which is where it's a realm full of demons, and it's ruled by the ancients. And the ancients, it's this small group of demons who are especially like powerful, and basically, you might almost say it's a soap opera. That's not a spoiler. It's basically a handful of demons, these ancients, and they did stuff to each other, and something happened, and as you find out more and more, you get a sense of who they were in relation to each other and what it was like. They're not long exposition dumps, and they don't get into the minutia, but as you get more and more of these exposition dumps, you do get a sense of what it was like to live amongst the ancients, and what the ancients what it's like to be an ancient. And the, as some have called the plot, the backstory average, which, yeah, I mean, there are definitely better ones out there. And it definitely is what drives the game forward, is learning more of this backstory and trying to figure out how to solve things. And the story is told in a number of cutscenes. A lot of these are basically POV. It's a first-person perspective game, so yeah, you stay in your POV. And then there are these exposition dumps, which are, it's basically, it's relatively simple animation, but it's very vivid, and it's as if the story is being read off these ancient scrolls. And it's a very memorable, there's a lot of memorable visuals in this, and that's one of the, yeah, I mean, I'm sure other, you know, like Asian style games have done similar things, but it is very, yeah, it lends this air of importance and of like these are the ancients. This is something that, you know, this is the lives of people who've lived for, you know, an incredible amount of time, and where this, yeah, it you know, gravitas. There's real gravitas there. And as I started up this game, I realized, much to my delight, that it has a profile system. This is a thing that I think every game ever made should have, because it just makes sense that if there's more than one person who has this, the same copy of, you know, who share this one copy of the game, they shouldn't have to be playing each other's, you know, progress. What if you want to start up another, you know, if you want to try it again, but you want to try a different difficulty setting, you know, what if you want to play on the same difficulty setting, but you don't want to overwrite the previous saves, all of these things, and it really solves all these issues very nicely. Now, you play as Lu Wang, and you have this partner he's been banished from the Shadow Realm. And he is, you know, yeah, he is a demon, Hoji. And Lu Wang and Hoji, sometimes they talk about, you know, what's going on. Sometimes they just say things. Sometimes they're not even saying things to each other. But what it boils down to is they talk, and that's a bad thing, because they're really annoying. Both their voices, both voices and what they say, they're just, it's kind of like the Nostalgia Critic points out in his review of the bad Sonic Saturday Morning cartoon, that the two goons have the voices of when you're a child and you're saying, and then they said, you know, you're quoting someone who annoys you, and then you make an annoying voice. That's kind of, yeah, Lu Wang and Hoji have not quite as bad as in that show, thankfully, but they're still pretty bad. Basically, the two of you need each other. You need a guide in all things Shadow Realm, and he needs someone who can actually physically interact with anything in the human world. And as I said, he was banished. He doesn't know why. And you will find out over the course of the game. And I, yeah, but, you know, as I've already said, I enjoyed, you know, getting more and more of the backstory. Part of the problem is that they're both very sarcastic. Don't get me wrong. I love sarcasm. Sarcasm is great when in, you know, I like to say everything in moderation. Sarcasm is very high on the list of things that need to be in moderation, because when sarcasm is all there is, it gets really grating. And yeah, that's kind of what happens here. I found myself really wishing I could just turn off their taunts and the meaningless chatter in the menu, and I almost never find myself wanting to do that. You know, when they actually talk about what's happened and you get like history lessons and such, you know, I didn't want that to be turned off. But yeah, when they're just saying, you know, ooh, I'm good at killing demons, or, yeah. This is one of the only reboots of, you know, first-person shooter reboots of a 90s first-person shooter. I have played more recent Quake because, you know, yeah, when Quake 3 came out, I was quite into that. I just barely played New Wolfenstein. I played a little bit of, yeah, see, I care so little about New Wolfenstein that I don't even remember the name. The New Order, maybe? Not the new one. Those I haven't even, those I literally know nothing about except that they exist. I really could not get into New Wolfenstein. I really, really like Wolfenstein 3D. But I just could not get into more recent Wolfenstein. I think it was just like early 2000s that it, yeah, something like that. I have not played new Duke Nukem. Yeah, I heeded the warning. Not played new Rise of the Triad, new Doom, not even Doom 3. I have played a number of first-person shooters that came out, you know, after the 90s, but just not really any of the reboots particularly. This is a really good reboot. If you've played either this or the original, and you feel like you also want to check out the other one, yeah, I'd say you'll probably, you know, as long as you appropriately adjust your, you know, going in and playing this, you can expect it to be just like a 90s shooter, of course, and vice versa. But yeah, they both have a lot, they have very similar styles to them, and they're both fun. I would say that, I mean, I have played, in preparation for this, I replayed all of the first one, including, you know, both expansion packs. So, you know, and I'll probably replay this one at some point. If I didn't replay the first one for this, then I might not have really been, you know, been that interested in replaying it. I think I'm more interested in replaying this, although there's not actually a lot of replayability. The choices you make are not all that different and impactful, but if we're just talking which game did I enjoy playing more, then overall I'd say this. And that's not, I don't have a, like, I enjoy modern shooters fine, but I did grow up on 90s shooters, so, you know, usually I will prefer the 90s shooter, but in this case, yeah. But yeah, you know, if you if you find that you like the style of one of these games, then you might want to play the other as well. Some have pointed out it has a real buddy cop kind of feel to it with you and Hoji, because you're, of course, you know, you get on each other's nerves a lot, but you do need each other. And as a reboot, you know, there are a lot of big differences between 90s first-person shooters and modern first-person shooters, and among them is that in the 90s, you know, we're talking health kits and the like, you know, you have to pick up to get more health, where in the more modern ones, it's usually health regeneration. You know, you carry 10 or more over-the-top, really destructive, huge weapons, like literally they're really big on the screen. Or in modern shooters, you carry maybe 2, you know, very realistic guns, and you can swap them out, but you know, it's you have one of them is like in the holster or on your back or something, and the other is in your hands. And you know, in the 90s, you could save anytime, anywhere. More modern ones, it's checkpoint. This does have checkpoint saving, but other than that, this follows the 90s ones, and it works out really well. Like, I've heard that that's one of the problems with Duke Nukem Forever, that, you know, it really cannot... It just doesn't work as a kind of throwback. It's the it mixes old and new of the dynamics I just mentioned, and it just really doesn't work out. And here it really does. Like, if you know, if 90s kid picked up this game, he would really be able to, you know, because it's a lot like a 90s game, and it works. It doesn't make you feel like you're missing things, that, you know, that things should be completely different. And it's also, you know, I don't know, but I figure the next Shadow Warrior game will probably be also, you know, like this, have a real 90s sensibility as far as those dynamics go. I don't think that it really wouldn't be Shadow Warrior if you could only carry 2 weapons, and yeah, so on and so forth. That just wouldn't at all work. As others have noted, you know, it really gets, you know, your nostalgia going. It's very retro, very old school. I knew going into this, because I read a lot of non-spoiler reviews going into movies and games, that in the last fourth or third of the game, it would basically be you know, you go into a room, you kill everyone in there. You know, you go into another room, kill everyone, on and on. I understand why that bothered the reviewer who noted it. And definitely, you know, I mean, basically the game should just be shorter so that you wouldn't have these levels where you do nothing other than just... But it didn't really bother me a lot. I expected it to. I expected to be very bored and it to be very rote, but no. I don't think I felt that it was that far below the rest of the game as far as, you know, variety and such, but yeah. And some have said that there's really only 4 or 5 hours of good gameplay here. I wasn't I don't feel like I passed a point where, okay, this is just starting to be. I think the thing is that not a lot changes in how you play. You get new weapons, you get new abilities, but at the end of the day, whether you play this for 10 minutes or 10 hours, it's about the same. And so, if you don't, if you play it and it's just, if you play it for 10 minutes and you're really not into it's not likely that you're going to get into it. After playing it for 10 minutes, I knew what to expect, basically, and I kept enjoying it. And someone noted that this backstory kind of stuff is maybe a little too dramatically self-indulgent. Yeah, at least a little, I would say. And the game took me 12 and a half hours to complete. I did not play the demo of this before getting it. Nor did I play the free version of the first one before I bought both on sale. But from descriptions it sounded like I'd enjoyed it, and I did in both cases. And the but yeah, the you know, if you figure that it's probably a good idea to play the demo of this, and there is one at least on PC. And I don't know about the others. I almost never play anything other than PC. And you can play the free version of the first one before or instead of buying the full version. And the free version is basically the full game. It's not the expansion packs, but yeah. And the I suppose that, yeah. Now, I played the demo of Hard Reset, which is from the same developers, and I still don't review demos, but just briefly, I'm gonna go into, there are a few things that they do in that game that they also do here, or in that are visible in that demo, at least. It's not impossible that I will at some point play the full version of Hard Reset. I love Cyberpunk, and in playing the demo, I really got into the world. But in 13 minutes, I had completed the demo, and before that time had passed, it was already repetitive and bland to me. And the same thing happened here. And we're in that again, just in the demo, basically there are environmental hazards almost everywhere. There's almost never an enemy that I couldn't just lure close to, there's almost always an environmental hazard. There are a lot in this, but there are plenty of areas with almost none of them. And yeah, it gets to be like, if you were making a very alternative game where you could only attack enemies by using environmental hazards, sure, that could be an interesting main like attack, mechanic. But in a shooter, it's just it feels like there shouldn't be that many of them, plain and simple. The point is you point and shoot. It's not, and it feels like it feels gratuitous. And basically anything in the demo, it was not as in this, it's basically anything that looks like it can be blown up can be blown up. Vehicles, anything that looks like it might have some kind of gas or Yeah, you know, the obvious one is just plain gas tanks, a la, you know, Left 4 Dead, but there are also a number of other things, yeah. And the moving on from the hard reset demo, in this you can sprint and dash, and basically dash is like sprinting, it's like a jump before you start sprinting. You know, if you dash forward, then basically you know, it's the same key, the sprint key, and if you just press sprint and forward once, then you just dash. But if you want to sprint, then he'll start by doing a dash and then go into sprinting. And yeah, it's very useful for getting away from enemies and dodging very quickly and such. For some reason, water sometimes kills you in this. By you touching it, I would say that it's that Lowain can't swim, but sometimes it seems just treading water. Basically, if you there are a lot of areas, including very early on, where basically like you're crossing a bridge or something, and there's water underneath you, and I just figured maybe I can go down there, maybe there'll be a secret or something. But jumping down there might kill you, so you know, make sure to always save, which you can, you know, you can quick save at any time, pretty much. And I believe also regularly save, but I almost never did anything other than quick save. And there are also save checkpoints. But basically, the idea is that if you jump down somewhere where the game hasn't made a way for you to get back up, then you will die. And I understand, you know, instead of the player being stuck somewhere, they couldn't. But I just feel like invisible borders would have been a better way to do that, because it seems really strange. I was incredibly surprised the first time it happened. And the first time it happened, it was literally the first time I touched water at all. And I thought, like, because some games do this. I was about to say some old shooters, but then, like, you know, the first Assassin's Creed does this. But, yeah, you know, basically, in some of these games, you couldn't swim, and touching water just immediately meant death. The tasks are slightly more varied than the 97 one, which I really appreciate, because, yeah, but only slightly. It really does play a lot like a 90s first-person shooter, but, you know, where that was almost exclusively, like, you know, a key hunt, and then occasionally you'd maybe have to, you know, there'd be minor puzzles, which, you know, actually this one doesn't really have, like, there are a few, like, really minor jumping puzzles, and there was one really simple puzzle. I don't know if maybe they were going to put in more puzzles, and then they just removed, they dropped the plans to, and then they left in the one, but, yeah, there's one puzzle. It's incredibly simple. You're at a train station. There are three train cars. You have to line them up so that you can pass. There's a lever for each train, which moves only that train. So it's not even one of those puzzles. And I'm almost certain there's like two positions for each train. And pulling the lever will just swap them between those two positions. So it doesn't get much easier. And That was literally it, you know, where in the old one you would maybe have to solve some puzzles, including some, like, really kind of more complex puzzles. But, you know, you'd maybe also have to find a repair kit so you could repair a vehicle and then use the vehicle to get to where you are, which might also not be completely obvious, but you know, in this it is very straightforward, but it does feel more varied. It's not just keys you're finding, so very much appreciated, but basically, you know, sometimes it's keys, sometimes you're pressing buttons, you're moving a crane so that you can walk across it, or you know, maybe it moves something out of your way, maybe you're toggling a bridge between different, yeah. And then there are these statues, which basically, yeah, the statues are much more common than actual keys. Basically, the statues are blue, red, or green. Each statue, excuse me, is one color, and the statues will be far apart, excuse me, and different doors will be green, red, or blue, and then there will sometimes be a major door which has all three, and that means you're supposed to go around finding all of them before you can, yeah, and that works pretty well, and it really is just about finding the statue, and sometimes there'll be, the statue will be covered in a force field, and that just means that there are enemies very close that you have to kill before you can, and then you stab the statue apart and that breaks. It's like a magical seal, basically. But yeah, it's very straightforward game, but it's not always completely easy. And something I really appreciate is when you check a lot of like closets and boxes and such for items, you can't accidentally close one of those. When you know, when you walk up to them, press, you know, point to them and press use, you open them. You can't accidentally close them. So you can't like be, you know, if there are a bunch of closets very close to each other, you can't accidentally close one while trying to open another or anything. The moment that you open it, you can't interact with the closet door itself. And basically, if there are, you know, anything inside of the closet, there can be more than one, you know, type of item, you pick it up immediately if you haven't reached full carry capacity in that, or full health in the case of that. And if you do, you know, if you have reached full capacity, then it'll just stay in there, and you can later go back to this still open closet and pick up the thing. But yeah, this is one of those games where you can never accidentally mess up pressing the use key. It can't accidentally do two different, you know, it's very, very clear what you're pointing toward. Even when you have, like, several clauses that you then just open and are, you know, have a bunch of items that, you know, you've just returned, you've used some of your ammo or whatever, and then you go to pick up, it still won't, you know, it's incredibly clear what you're pointing to, and it'll be highlighted in green if you can pick it up and red if you can't, regardless of what the reason for you not being able to pick it up is. And yeah, you actually, like, you can also pick up things by just walking over them or walking into them, but if you don't do that, if you just point to them, then you have to press the use key in order to pick them up again, unless they're inside a closet you just opened. Now, apparently the PlayStation 4 version of this has a bug with the friends list and has really bad console controls, and apparently the Xbox One also has bad console controls, so, you know, buyer beware. Some say it's a bit of a dated game, and as a lot say, it's fun but lacks variation. That's really the main, yeah, and it's pretty charming, but also a very shallow game. And the upgrades, as one reviewer excellently pointed out, you need to use the upgrades or you'll constantly be at a disadvantage with the enemies, but the upgrade menu is really pace breaking because most of the game, like I said, it's straightforward. You're always running around looking for something, you know, killing enemies by the dozens. That's basically it. But then you have these upgrade menus where, yeah, it stops the game dead. And, you know, you can understand why, like, something, you know, it's, there are a lot of different upgrades. So, yeah, but the thing is, it really didn't have to be this kind of static menu thing where you just, like, you're technically not really forced to go in and pick upgrades, but like the reviewer pointed out, if you don't do this, then you'll, you know, as you progress, you fight more and more enemies and you fight tougher enemies, so you need these upgrades. And the thing is that, especially at first, because some of these are upgrades to, you know, some of the unlockables are upgrades to other unlockables, but a lot of them you can just grab immediately. And that means that the first time you're looking at maybe 20 different ones that you can get. And it's just like, well, what do I even, I've barely been playing the game at all. I don't know what's good to get. And they didn't need to do it like this. They could have, basically, every time you get another point for the upgrade, because you get just 1 point at a time, and sometimes hours pass between you getting 2 points, how about just the moment that you get one of these points, just, you know, it briefly offers you maybe two or three different options. Just make it completely guided, because the game overall is almost entirely linear anyway. So just say, you know, okay, you can upgrade this, this, or this, and there'll be three different ones, and maybe just give the player 15 seconds to choose one of them. If you don't choose, if the player doesn't choose one, it chooses one automatically, and that'll be that, you know. So it's just, so you don't get bogged down. A lot of them do tend to boil down to something relatively simple anyway, and worse, they, a lot of them have these, like really philosophical, like, it's not a lot of words, but it does get, you know, only, like, something like, only the koi that swim upstream are especially, or something, and then afterwards it uses just a few words to say what it actually is, and it's just, you didn't need all that. It's just, that's something, for that, just make it clear what is the actual description of what I'm looking at, and what is this, you know, verbose kind of thing about it, because those really should be separate. It's especially annoying when you keep, you know, reading the same, you know, like I said, hours pass between them, and so, you know, you forget what was this upgrade that you didn't get. You know, why was it that I, there's one here, why did I not get that? And then you go back to read, the coin only swim upstream because, you know, and it's just, yeah. And the, you know, as with anything like that, some of them are kind of useless. Some of them are, like, ridiculously, you know, really overpowered. There's a lot of overpowered going on in this. And, you know, it can be difficult to tell exactly what you'll need and such. But that's, it's fairly standard for, you know, a game like this. And, like I said, I found that the ones that I cared about, I got fairly early on. Like, less than a third of the way through, I was out of upgrades that I felt like those are ones I really want. And after that, it was just, well, I guess this sounds more interesting than this other. You know, I don't want either of them. I don't want any of these. There are 10 different ones. And none of them sound all that interesting to me, but I guess this one sounds a little better than this other, and that's, you know, you get far too many of them. is also, but yeah, the there is a reasonable level of variation to the different upgrades. You know, and there are different, like, there are chi powers, and then there are, yeah, see, I forget the diff, yeah, it's like powers, and maybe the other one is called skills or something, and the chi powers are ones that you actually activate, and the skills, I want to say, are ones that are just like constant, or they activate under certain circumstances, but you know, and that is something I really pre I think it should always be, you know, the ones you activate should be on one side, and the ones that are like passive or, you know, activate automatically at times should be on the other, because the they're very different things, and yeah, you know, I prefer when I'm getting an upgrade to know, is this a passive thing? Is it something I can turn on whenever I want? Is it something that's specific to certain areas? And yeah. And the, you know, there are, and yeah, there are a lot of different ways to heal with these, and that's it's really just, you know, throwing those at you like candy. And there are four different ones that are basically, if you're about to die, you're gonna do more damage, and that's it. Like, two of these are upgrades to the other two, but still, four different ones for that same basic thing. I get the idea that, okay, if you're almost dead, you'll want to do more damage so that you can, you know, get out of this situation. You know, the options are heal your way out of the situation, or, you know, be more powerful so that you can get out of the, and I don't think that's cheap. I think it's fine to have this kind of, you know, yeah, when you're about to die, you're gonna have some an incredibly powerful attack. You know, that's fine. But that many of them, that's, yeah. It seems like they had more, like almost like they had a certain amount of upgrade slots, and then they just did all the ones that, yeah. And the, you know, they're really giving you points for these, like, yeah, just throwing them at you, except for the weapon upgrades. Those are really expensive. Like, when you first get, like, when you get your first couple of weapons and you check out the upgrades, they sound great, and some of them are really, really, really useful, but it also, it seems like, well, I mean, you know, the, okay, it'll basically cost me almost all of my money if I get all of the upgrades for the one gun I have now. But by the time I get the next one, I'll have earned a ton. No. If you spend all your money on upgrades very early on, it's going to be a long time before you can upgrade very much else. And I just, you know, that's fine, but it's just, it's a bit, you know, I really, given that the powers, I could basically just pick and choose. You know, there are ones that upgrade other powers, but other than that, it's, you know, you can get some of the most powerful powers immediately. You can unlock them right away, or you can save them for later. So you might think that the same is true of weapons, that, you know, you could just upgrade the, but some of them are incredibly expensive. And yeah, just, you know, don't upgrade something until you're sure that you've gotten, you know, look at the most expensive ones for any weapon you have now, and realize that there are going to be bigger and better weapons that you can also upgrade, but not if you spend too much on upgrading right now. But basically, you know, you have, there's a chi power that lets you it's basically like a defense kind of, you know, you hold up, and the base level of it is just damage from in front, but then you can upgrade it to other, you know, that when you have it up, it's like a shield basically, but, you know, not a very visual shield, just like, yeah, like a psychic power kind of shield that, but yeah, you know, you can upgrade it to where it's around other, all sides, you can upgrade it to where it's all kinds of attacks, that, you know, you can upgrade it to where it'll bounce back some of the, like, you know, I think melee attacks can be, you know, reversed so that the enemy harms themselves and such. There's this really useful attack that sends out this small arc of energy, and it can go through enemies, so that, you know, it can bypass shields, it can go through some, like, small walls. Like, if I don't know that I could ever, like, if I was one room away from an enemy and there was a wall between us, I don't think I could have gone through that. But if you're, like, seeing them right around a corner or something, then, yeah, it won't, like, stop because it hits the wall there. It'll just go through, again, as long as it's nice and thin. And, you know, one power is that each of these, every time you do a chi strike, that heals you. So this, you know, small arc energy thing becomes incredibly useful. Also, because you don't have to touch the enemy, you know, you send it flying, and it's not necessarily going to fly very far, but especially not unupgraded, but, you know, it puts a little bit of distance between you and still heals. Then there's this one where basically you spin, you know, you stick out your sword and spin, like, what is that, 360 degrees, I guess. And, yeah, that's, I found it less useful than it sounds, because the enemies aren't all going to be, like, right, like, touching you. And I feel like it could have been just that, you know, just give it a little more range, or maybe make it that you can move slightly while you do it, so you can move closer to an enemy, and yeah. And there's this really effective stab, that's also the one you use for the statues, and yeah, you'll use that one a lot on more powerful enemies. And you can knock back enemies, there's this kind of trap that kind of picks them up and holds them in front of you for a few seconds. And there's not like a bar of energy that needs to be recharged. You can use any of these however many times you like. There is just a fraction of a second of delay on the physics at times, but it's enough that you can tell that it's off. It's very smooth gameplay. The opening is very Kill Bill. Like, you're in this really elaborate, like, kind of restaurant, traditional place, and you are cutting people apart with, you know, you with your sword, them with their swords. Yeah. Where in the original, I barely ever used the katana. Here, They kind of inversed it. Maybe it's entirely intentional, actually. Here, I almost never used anything but the katana, and you know, part of that is the powers that I just mentioned. But yeah, also just, you know, cutting enemies apart. You can cut off individual limbs, and sometimes the enemy won't die from that, so they'll come at you, you know, zombie style with a missing, like they'll come crawling at you, or they'll come at you with one arm missing or the like, and you can cut off their dominant arm, taking away their weapon or maybe their shield in the case of some. And you also, if you right click, you can do this slower attack, but I found myself very rarely using that. You know, some enemies can block attacks, and if they block a quick attack, you know, whatever, but if they block a heavier attack, you know, you just wasted time with something that didn't lead to an attack. It's very hack and slash, and it's very easy. You know, others have pointed to the fact that you can actually, you know, you can heal just by fighting with, you know, you not fighting regularly with the sword. It's, you know, but just as long as you're doing the chi strikes, that's it, you know, and the chi strikes do mean, you know, you don't have to kill, you just have to do some damage with a chi strike and it'll heal. The violence, some have noted, it's this kind of grindhouse over the top. It's so violent, it's funny. You have a pistol. It looks really cool, but it's just fine. The weapons tend to be just fine, in spite of some really cool ideas there. You have a crossbow that fires sticky bombs that you detonate when you want to, and yeah, still didn't really use it. You know, a shotgun, which can be upgraded to have more barrels and, like, you know, explosive kind of, yeah, a submachine gun, which you can dual wield, upgrade to dual wield, a flamethrower that can throw these fire bombs, a rocket launcher, which allows manual guiding with this laser kind of, you know, it's like a laser pointer, and where you point to, the rocket will go. And more than, I think, half a dozen times in this, you get to mount a minigun, which is also something that should be in every game. Maybe I should make a list. I'm not even talking, like, you know, I played the you know, Beyond Good and Evil not too long ago. That couldn't have had, you know, this kind of, if there were a mounted minigun in that, then you couldn't take limbs off with it and like blow bodies apart the way you can, you know, take limbs. Well, you know, just shoot them completely apart the way you can in this, but, you know, just make it something else, make it not kill them, make it not violent, whatever. A mounted gun in every game, that is something I promise you. For a while there is this, it seems like you're gonna get a new weapon once per level, but it doesn't quite work out like that. But I do think this does a better job than the original of spacing out when you get the weapons. At first I thought that it was going to be the whole game before I had all the weapons, but it's not. At first they're a little more economical about doling them out. It was especially compared to my freedom in choosing upgrades. I was like, well, okay, I can choose between all these different upgrades, but I can't choose between very many different actual weapons yet. But they'll, you know, you'll get them, and You know, it's not one of those games where the very last level you get this, you know, most of the very best weapons you will get to use for several levels. You don't just get them right before the game is over. And it is the it does a better job than the original of making each time you get a weapon really have an impact. Like you genuinely, the first level you only have you only start out with the sword, and even just you getting the pistol is treated like an event. It's not just, okay, well, the game is starting, I have, you know, I have the first couple of weapons already, or I get them immediately from the first couple of enemies I kill. No, you actually you get them gradually, and you feel like you know something, like you're getting something new and something cool. Where yeah, in the first one, it pretty much just throws you all the weapons almost immediately, and it just yeah, there's no building up to the cooler ones. And the but yeah, you know, early on it seems like it's just one weapon per level, and it's, you know, it's maybe only like towards the end of the level that you get it, but that's also it would also have gotten boring if they kept to that. And the you know, the cheese strikes are these simple, easy to, you know, easy to remember, easy to use combinations. And whenever you have the, basically, if you have any weapon out that isn't the katana, then there's this, you know, you can press Q for just a quick strike with the katana. If you have the katana out, then Q has him throw one of the shuriken. In this, you have infinite shuriken, although they're tied to your stamina. So, you know, and stamina is something you can upgrade. But if you don't upgrade it very early on, yeah, you can't throw very many shuriken very fast before you have to wait for it to, yeah. I wanted to like the shuriken, but they have, excuse me, they have this auto aim, and they can kind of ricochet and arc an angle and such, and that just makes them very difficult to use. There are, well, for one thing, for triggering the environmental hazards, which it's always just hit them once. That, you know, that's easy if you're running around with the projectile weapon, which, you know, if you have anything out other than the katana, then it's easy enough. But why would you have anything out? You know, most of the time, I didn't, and I've certainly seen a number of other commenters, you know, reviewers point out, you know, the katana is the most fun to use. And yeah, I mean, sometimes the kind of arc of energy can be useful for that. Well, sometimes it can be, and sometimes it's just, you know, run up to it, you know, get close to the thing, just use your katana and then sprint away. But yeah, you know, it shouldn't be difficult to do with the shuriken. And the shuriken don't do a lot of damage. If you're attacking something in the distance, you probably want to use just the cheese strike. And again, you can make it like, I think the very first one you're made to get the stab, but you can make it the second thing you get. That means you get to use that for almost all of the game, and it doesn't reach as far as the shuriken, but it's more powerful, and it's, you know, I've already mentioned that it can go through, slightly go through walls and such. It also hits more than one enemy easily. It's not the kind of projectile where the moment it hits something, it stops. No, the wave just keeps moving until it's, you know, for the range that it has. So, you know, there can be five enemies really close by that it can hit, or there can be one. But yeah, so the shuriken, it just feels like are kind of, yeah, are basically pretty useless. Which, you know, ultimately it's fine because you're not really made to use them. And yeah, basically using the chi strikes, you tap one of the four movement, you know, WA is the one of the movement keys twice, and then you press, you know, you press or you hold and release one of, you know, either of the mouse keys, and yeah, that's how you activate it. And that means that you don't tend to do one while trying to do the other. And yeah, you know, like there are times where you try to do it and then, you know, for whatever reason it doesn't quite work. But it rarely, it's they're simple enough that it rarely gets messed up, and yet you can tell them apart. Some have said that this is very awkward, and some even that it, you know, like hurts their hands, and I can't speak to that. I only ever play 45 minutes, well, almost never. I'm certainly not supposed to play more than 45 minutes in a row, and I rarely do play more than 45 minutes in a row, and so it was never a problem to me, but, you know, the damage is done. I already have partial carpal tunnel, so if you don't and you play for more than 45 minutes, yeah, maybe it is. And that is something, there's no other way for you to do these chi strikes as far as I know, and you do have to do at least some. It's, yeah. At the end of a fight in an area and at the end of the level, you're rated for how well you did, and that's part of how you earn when you'll next get to, you know, upgrade something. And the, you know, like I said, they practically throw these out. There are also secret areas that you'll get more, you know, points for this, but I didn't go out of my way to find secret areas. I did find a number of them, and I didn't go out of my way to fight really varied and such, and I was still getting a ton of them, so yeah. Some demons you kill will, you know, you'll be able to get their heart or their head, and basically the heart, you basically grab a demon heart, and then you move close to some demons. It's not the really especially powerful demon, as far as I know. It's just the minor ones, but yeah, you know, you press attack, and he'll, you know, you can, in this you can only carry one heart at a time, but where in the original it basically like made a clone of you that then also fought, and that's okay, I guess, but you know, the Duke Nukem 3D stuff is cooler than that, I would say. But you know, where there are machines that can make you tiny for puzzles, and then, you know, you have a jetpack that you have to conserve or use the right places, and then you can make, you know, you can put out a hologram of yourself that the enemies will attack that can give you some breathing moments, and, you know, those are far more interesting than a clone. But anyway, in this, you squeeze the heart, and it basically, like, I guess blows up their hearts or something. You know, you see them grab their chest, and then they fall over. So, you know, heart attack, it's super effective, I guess. And the head, it's basically this big demon head, and you can make it, like, spew out fire. So, you know, very similar to the first. The something I just found was that in the first, you find these heads, you know, the same way you find other ammo, just every so often. But in this, you know, both the head and the heart, you know, certain enemies, when they die, well, actually the heart is rare, I think, but every time you kill a certain demon enemy, their head will come off, and you can use that, you know, the fire that spews. And honestly, it didn't take me long to start the practice of simply only using the demon head to fight those demons, and then just, yeah, use the head to kill that demon, and then when he's dead, pick up the head and have full ammo again, because it never, you know, I didn't play on the highest difficulty setting, but yeah, there's always more fire in the head than was needed to kill the demon, so it just ended up feeling like, you know, a deus ex machina out of a dangerous situation, because no matter how many of these demons there are, you know, like, I had to kill off the smaller ones or they would, you know, swarm me. But once I killed off the smaller ones, even if there were two big demons in the same place, just use the fire to kill one of them, pick up his head, use the fire to kill him, pick up his head, and now I have full ammo again. You come across a lot of human corpses in, you know, areas that you explore as this demon invasion is taking place, you know, and some will be like completely skinned and, yeah. And you fight some human enemies. The police, in spite of the fact that they should be in Zilla's pocket, will sometimes fight you, and some enemies will attack with swords, and some human enemies will attack with swords. A lot of the enemies have this nice, creepy design to them. They mostly look, they're mostly humanoid. You know, but clearly not quite human, very clearly monsters. But yeah, the basic, you know, they do tend to be two arms, two legs, a head, you know. And I do really appreciate there's pretty decent variation to their looks. They're not like gray and bland like I criticized Killing Floor for, you know, the enemies and that being. They're nicely varied, and you can really clearly tell them apart. It's not this kind of... One of my problems with Fear 3 is that it's this very grungy, nasty kind of just ugly, like, settings and such, and I can appreciate that it's supposed to be taking place and such, but for comparison, something like Max Payne 3 is also taking place in a very, you know, in a place that has a lot of ugly, you know, you're running around the favelas, but it's still more, it quote-unquote looks better, you know, it's more attractive, and at the end of the day, we do, you know, we are playing, it's not a job, it's something we're doing for recreation, so it should look nice and sound nice and such, even with that adjusted for, you know, this kind of thing. And yeah, I mean, you're looking at these demons in this, they don't look nice like you want to get to know them, but you can tell that, you know, they have pretty nicely varied looks to them. And, you know, they'll vary some in strength, size, attack pattern. A lot of the enemies do tend to, you know, they do tend to attack with melee, though, and that, you know, and though they have different attacks, that does mean you end up dealing with them in more or less the same way, and that's a little unfortunate. And for that, you do kind of lose some of the coolness of what they, of how different they look from each other. And some of them have abilities such as blocking your katana, teleporting, turning invisible, throwing fireballs, maybe flying. The ones that can throw fireballs, some of those can also fly, and they will eventually kamikaze and some enemies just kamikaze in general without ever flying. But you know, that does mean that if you don't want to bring out your gun and shoot them, you very rarely have to. Like, sometimes they'll fly close enough, even before kamikazing, to just let you use the arc, you know, the energy arc attack. You know, you can use shurikens, but it takes forever. And that's actually, it's a little strange. There isn't an ability, which I'm almost 100% certain there's no ability to make shurikens more powerful or anything. There's just the, you can upgrade stamina and thus how many shurikens you can throw in quick succession, and yeah. But yeah, you very rarely have to have something out other than your katana. One enemy has this kind of shield, and it's basically, like, some of them are a little varied in size, but the typical shield is basically as tall as the enemy is, so you can't just attack just slightly under, slightly over the shield. And dashing takes you a little too far to effectively attack, so basically you're running around him and making sure to get just, you know, just around the side enough that you can attack with the sword, and it kind of wakes you up, because otherwise you can just kind of just swing the sword in the general direction of the enemies, and you know, as long as you keep going for long enough, they'll end up dead. And they do also carry fire sticks, which means they're toast if apocalypse shows up. Then there's another type that kind of raises the dead, and sometimes can also make a shield out of two or three of the other enemies that, you know, are powered by those enemies. That means you have to kill those enemies before the shield subsides, and fighting that type just got really tedious, and yeah, you know, ended up just trying to get as close to him as possible, just do the chi stab a ton of times, and it was still just, it takes too long, it's really annoying. And then there's this really obnoxious, like, I don't know, like Yeti, or I don't know, it's like an animal. It's not quite a grizzly bear, but some kind of, like a mix between a wolf and a grizzly bear, maybe. And basically its weak spot is on its back, and that means that when it runs at you, you just have to dodge it, and then hopefully you lured it to run into something, so it takes a second or two before it turns around, and then you can get up and stab it in the back. And it's not just the back either, it's the upper back, so you really have to get it, yeah, really annoying. And there are definitely too many of those in the game, if you ask me. You can set some enemies on fire, which can be quite useful, and some and that's part of where the environmental hazards come in. You know, some of those are just explosions. Some can also set enemies on fire, and sometimes they will continually pour out of an opened manhole or a straight up demonic portal or the like. And there is some friendly fire, which is quite nice, especially when you get one of the really big ones to fight some of the others, so you can get him to not attack you constantly. And yeah, something I do like about the big demons that, you know, give you the fire-breathing heads, they have this kind of like a lasso or some kind of thing where they'll sometimes catch you and then pull you to, and you can kind of like cut yourself free in time. But yeah, you know, it's like the thing with Gandalf at the end of that, you know, that demon, something like that. Yeah, pretty cool. And there's this enemies can become enraged, which means that they're basically they change appearance slightly to become more threatening looking, more red and dark and such. And yeah, that means they're attacking faster and hitting harder, and yeah. And when they're enraged, some of your chi moves won't affect, like, you, I don't think you can, not without the upgrade, you can't trap an enraged enemy, and yeah. And there's also this other chi power that can scare the enemies, but without an upgrade, it doesn't work on the enraged. I ran into a few glitchy areas where basically the enemy would stand a place where I couldn't hit them with, you know, I could maybe use shuriken and the arc, but I couldn't quite, you know, I couldn't touch them directly with my sword. And it was clear that it was a glitch those times, because the enemy was trying to move to get to where I was. And some of them, they couldn't even actually shoot. You know, the melee enemy staying, you know, being a place where he can't attack me and I can't attack him with just, you know, melee, and him clearly moving towards me, yeah, it's a glitch. And sometimes these are actually, like, you know, you have to kill all these enemies before you can proceed. And yeah, once or twice I couldn't quite tell where the enemies were at first, so I had to really scout for it. But yeah, there weren't that many. But just be aware that that's something that happens. Boss fights tend to, you know, they're kind of, they look good, but they're a real slog to get through. They, you know, basically it's usually easy to see what you have to do, but you just have to do, it's kind of a grind, basically. But yeah, the real boss fights, you're fighting the ancients, and they are these huge demons. Like, if you laid horizontally, you'd make up like half of one of their feet. They are hundreds of meters tall, and just like, you know, you can be sprinting for a while and they can take one step and be close to you again. So yeah, that's pretty cool. But just, yeah, like I said, really grindy. And I quite appreciate, during these boss fights, there are these respawning pickups of health and ammo. There are a lot of cool designs on this. Lo Wang himself looks pretty cool. The graphics vary, but sometimes they really are excellent, and there are some really beautiful sights in this. That's, you know, something very much, something I'm taking away from this very much, is the sights, the memorable locations and designs and such. There's a lot of color. The kind of lasso thing is like this glowing orange kind of thing. The fire that pours out of the head is this kind of yellowish fire. The one that can raise the dead, I think it's called the shaman, has this kind of green to him, and there's and kind of glowy light green. And there's this enemy, I think it's called Mother, that kamikazes, blows himself up, and also rolls these, you know, green goo kind of things that also blow up, and they also glow green. And yeah, it's, you know, it's very easy to recognize. And just, yeah, you know, I mean, when you think about it, almost everything you fight is a demon from the Shadow Realm. And when you see the Shadow Realm, it's a very dark place, but they all look so different that, you know, I think that's also part of what kept me from being bored, in spite of it maybe being a little overlong, in spite of, like I said, you know, within 10 minutes you've seen it. But yeah, the enemy design and such keeps it interesting, and of course every so often they'll, you know, you'll meet a new enemy. The bloom does get blinding a number of times. And I already mentioned you know, there are these masks. For example, the golem that you chase has this mask, and some of the masks are like porcelain, some of them are clay. The music is quite good. It's a very easy game, and that's again where, you know, the moment that you have all these really overpowered, really big weapons, either the enemies are then also going to be really overpowered and such, or it's going to end up an easy game. And here it ended up an easy game. There are four main difficulty settings, and then completing the game unlocks an additional difficulty setting and also a new game plus mode where you keep all your weapons, and I haven't tried it, but I believe also all upgrades and such. Certainly would make sense. But yeah, playing it, I didn't really get much of a sense of danger. I didn't really feel like I needed to apply myself in order for it to turn out well. I just pointed my sword in the direction of the enemies and kept attacking, and that worked out. Some have experienced this save glitch a couple of different save glitches where every time you save, it erases the previous save you made. I didn't run into that. And some had problems with that when they saved at it, when they reached a checkpoint, then the next time they loaded, it would go to the checkpoint before that. I didn't experience that, but I also did tend to just quick save. And yeah, you can do that almost any time. There was at least once where it didn't let me, but I was right in the middle, right in the thick of a big fight. So that was probably why. And when I tried a little later, you can do it during fights. You just can't be quite in the middle of the thick of it, that's all. There is armor, but I didn't find that many pickups for it, and it's the kind of thing where one pickup will give you a certain amount of armor. So if you find more than one that gives 25, they're not going to raise you even to 26. They will just get you back up to 25. And, you know, I guess it's fine. I would rather there be very few of these smaller ones than that finding two and having avoided taking damage, you know, that meant you can't get. It kind of irks me when you find armor and it's saying 25, you know, like later on you do get ones of 50 and even of 75, but if you find two early ones of 25, they can only get you to 25. And yeah. Some of the secrets you really easily find. It's to where they really shouldn't be calling them secrets, but a few of them actually have textures from the, and some even sounds from the original, which is pretty cool. And there are also a couple of, you know, there are several places over the course of the game where, like, there will be these arcade game, you know, machines of the original game and other games from the developer and publisher. And then there was in the last maybe third or so, there was this distinct parody element of Half-Life. And I was like, is the game supposed to be a parody? Like, the, you know, the way that, you know, Far Cry 3 Blood Dragon is, because that's very distinctly a parody, And that's very self-aware, and this didn't really seem like, again, I don't know if it's like they left in just the one element after scrapping, after getting rid of the plans to do more, but the game isn't that, like I said, it's just, it's sarcastic taunts and such. It doesn't, yeah, it's not all that self-aware or that overall like a parody. It is more just like a product that throws in jokes and such. Now, the maps tend to be fairly large, relatively simple in design, and sometimes pretty bland, and they're a little too open, which means you have to backtrack, even from very early on. Like, there was one of the first levels, I could not tell that there was a path where I was supposed to go. I did manage to find it, but it didn't look like there was a path, and I tried a bunch of very obvious paths, and some of that led to secrets, and some of that I walked into areas that I then couldn't quite find. You know, there was a way back out of, but I had to really apply myself to find it. But then eventually I realized, oh, this other place, there actually was a path to proceed. And yeah, there are a lot of dead ends. And this is a game that does not let you go past the point of no return. You can't go past the point of no return in a direction that isn't the correct one. You know, if you pass a point of no return, it's because you're going in the right direction. You know, you can, like, jump down and, well, you can't get back up there. You know, but it means that you're on the right path. If it wasn't the right path, then you would die, like I said, of the water. And something that is good when you're running around, there are tons of different, you know, sometimes very open and such. The door you're supposed to go through glows. You know, at first I thought it was just the first time you reach a certain door, the first time that you can open a certain door, it glows. If you go through the door and then you're going around in different places to find one of the statues that you stab, for example, and you then get back to the door, it will glow again. Basically, if a door glows, it means that's the path. That if, you know, there are doors that you can open that don't glow. But, yeah. And also, you know, when you can, if you, it, the this glow is the same when you're just checking closets for items and such. I already mentioned you pass skinned corpses. There are also bloodied floors. You can tell a lot of the levels apart. Not, you know, at first I thought it was every level you could tell apart. Not quite, but yeah, you know, and they change up where you are and what it looks like enough. You know, I already mentioned you start out in this establishment of, you know, this very traditional place. You go through this old city. You go to Lo Wang's own house through a cemetery. There are some levels on the docks, and, you know, there's this mountain area that, yeah, you know, a number of different areas. And even if you're in the same overall area several levels in a row, there will tend to be very different areas. Like, the docks has three or four very distinctly different areas to it. This has a survival mode, which comes with three maps, which might be there from the start. By the time I realized it was there and wasn't just a difficulty setting, because I didn't really look that closely there, I had already completed the first couple of levels and thus had at least played, you know, two of the levels. But anyway, the three levels are this fortress, which is not in the rest of the game, and then the old city and the cemetery. And they're in, this mode is entirely separate from the plot. And you start with just, you know, basically just the katana and, you know, no upgrades and such. And, you know, you fight these growing, you know, these waves that grow in intensity and amount, and there'll be a new weapon maybe at the end of a wave, and, you know, there'll be pickups during the wave of health and ammo. You're not forced to play it for the plot, and yeah, it's entirely separate. And that this does come with the Viscera cleanup detail. Excuse me. It is the only version of the Viscera cleanup detail that I've played, so I can't compare it to the others. Basically, you're running around with a mop, a sensor, and you've got rubber gloves on your hands, and you pick up and carry items one by one, like in Amnesia. And the, you know, you're basically moving items into an incinerator, and there are these big bins for the, you know, that you can put a number of items into, and then you can throw the entire bin in the incinerator. And then there are these, you know, you're using the mop to mop up blood, and then you have to, you know, refresh it, and, you know, basically, yeah, you know, put the, dip the mop into the water bucket, and eventually the water bucket will be so full of blood that you have to get rid of that. And yeah, you're picking up debris, shells, weapons, and like with the survival mode, you're not forced to play this. And this one is entirely different, you know, you it's a different program, it's a different game that you just start up somewhere else. And, you know, ultimately it's not really for me. Simulator games are simply not. But if I were to say one thing about it for that might matter to people who would like to play it, is the physics do get a bit annoying. You accidentally, you can't see what you're picking up. You know, there's not an indicator on the middle, at the center of the screen that you can, you know, which you do have in, say, Amnesia, so you can't see what you're going to be picking up, and sometimes it picks something that you really didn't think it would. And yeah, just, you know, in general, the physics, you'll accidentally knock over the bin. Maybe you're carrying it and you know it accidentally hits something else, even something on the floor, and everything goes flying out of it, or you knock over the bucket, or, you know, things like that. Now, the something that I was not sure how this would handle, given the original, was the humor, because they could definitely not do what do it the same way that they did in the original. The you know, the stuff about women, you know, they still could, although they'd catch more heat for it today. But the race stuff, they definitely couldn't. So yeah, they did a lot to kind of get away from that, and really a lot of the humor in this kind of feels like the you know, the developers are standing next to you as you're playing it, saying, yeah, the original one, that was really racist, that was really offensive, We're sorry. We're sorry. And it ends up just with so much safe humor, safe comedy, jokes that are inoffensive and unfunny. You know, you can be funny without being offensive, but here they were so scared of being offensive that, yeah. And it's not even like, they're genuinely just jokes that aren't funny. They're so scared. Although at times the race stuff does get borderline, like maybe not, it gets racial, you know. And it does, they are still, you know, they still can't tell Chinese and Japanese, you know, apart. But yeah, the humor, bland, annoying, flat, lame. But then, you know, they do have this kind of geisha design. Some of the masks, I think, are at least, yeah, borderline racial. They've got the laborers, the labor hats, and they have the fortune cookies with, you know, joke messages and such. I've reviewed other parts of this franchise. The links are in the description box.